Grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let's begin our day together with singing some carols. Verse one, He is born. Remain seated and we'll sing carols.
He is born, the child has come.
Yeah. Jesus, our Brother kind and good, what's
This is the Lord's table, not a Presbyterian table, so all of you who love the Lord Jesus Christ are welcome to commune with the Lord today. So you should have got a little communion cup as you come in. Did everybody get the cup? And you know, we will need to add time to pray because of the way we must serve communion, so I will tell you when to eat and when to drink, and Nathan will play, so we have lots of time to sit and enjoy resting with God. I want to thank all of you who were involved in last night's dinner and music. It was a lovely night. It was truly a wonderful night, and it made me realize how much I missed being together with you and singing together with you. So I want to thank everyone who came and put it all together. I forgot to announce there was a key found on the floor. So if you're missing, it looks like a house key to me. If you're missing a house key, I have it here. This coming Friday is something new for Haney. We're having a Christmas fun night. It's for all of us, and there'll be games, party games, board games, sports, some activities. Come and have some fun together. It's been a long time since we've relaxed and been together, so we're trying something new. This Friday, 6 o'clock. The only thing you have to bring is finger food to share. The food is, like a potluck finger food. We are having a Christmas lunch on December the 18th, that's a Sunday, after church. The sandwiches are provided, but I'm looking for 9 people who will bring some baking. And if you bring one thing that you baked for Christmas, and then we'll share it among the plates so each table has a variety, and also if we could have some gluten-free baking that has to be kept separate. But if any of you could do a plate of baking, that would be wonderful, and we'll share it together on December the 18th. The Christmas services are Christmas Eve at 7, Christmas Day at 10. Please spread the word. I want to remind you to give Shirley feedback. She is learning how to be a minister. She's in the final years. She hopes to have a church by after the spring. And she's learning the skills she needs to be a minister. And one of those skills is, how do you introduce change? How do you help people be comfortable with something that's new? And so she loves Tazze services. I love them. She introduced them to us. So give her some feedback as to how that went. Doesn't matter if you came to the services. This is all part of how she learned. You can email her, or there's an envelope in the narthex if you just want to slip your answers in there. We are supporting Presbyterian World Service and Development through our Giving Tree. You can make an undesignated donation, but if you want to choose a particular project, you just need to look in the catalog, put the ornament on the tree with your name and the gift that it's intended for, and mark your envelope with the amount for PWS&D. I want to thank Marla. Marla has made a beautiful display in the library of Christmas books. And so I encourage you to pop into the library anytime to borrow these Christmas books. And she's also laid out a number of Christmas cards on the table that are there for you to take. So please help yourself, and thank you, Marla. My last announcement concerns the coffee roster, and I want to encourage you to sign up for January. Last week we didn't have coffee because no one had signed up. So we're good for the rest of December, we're okay for the rest of this month, but we will need to start signing up again for next month. Let's prepare for worship with a few moments of prayer. Let's pray. Flora and Linda, would you lead us in the call to worship?
So
seated. Let's pray together. God of wisdom and understanding, of peace and promise, you are the giver of life, and you live in us. You have welcomed us as your children and called us to live out your image with hospitality toward each other. In Jesus Christ, you offer us living water to wash away our sin and sorrow and call us back to paths of justice and righteousness. With the Holy Spirit, you baptize us for service and life in community, refreshing us each day with your presence and purpose. Glory and honor and praise be yours, Creator, Christ, and Spirit, this day and every day, now and evermore. God of peace and promise, we confess that we have taken your commitment to us for granted. We assume that what we do is acceptable to you, yet we judge others more harshly. We have been slow to welcome others, especially if their cultures or convictions differ from ours. You call us to repentance, but we resist seeing anything needing change in our hearts or our habits. Forgive our self-satisfied attitudes and challenge us with your vision of a peaceable kingdom where all can be made new. Amen. Receive the good news in peace. With great mercy, God forgives what we have confessed and offers us new life in Jesus Christ. Receive the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. And be at peace with God, with each other, and within yourselves. Let's stand and sing together, "Lo, how a rose e'er blooming."
Jesus.
be seated. Now, the Vanderbilt School of Divinity has a library, and it offers many wonderful works of art for free on the internet. And so I'm sharing with you today this painting by Edward Hicks. He is a 19th century Quaker minister and an artist. And this is his painting of Isaiah chapter 11, which is our text for today. Now, he painted this vision from Isaiah at least 62 times over his life, and he was painting it again when he died. And over time, the paintings changed. He was beginning to become discouraged by the conflicts in the world, particularly within his religious community. And as time went on, he began to make the wild animals look increasingly ferocious. So, judging by the face of the lion, I think this must be a relatively late painting in his life. Now, you can see there are many different animals in the painting. There's a lion, a leopard, a tiger. There's also an ox, goat, sheep. You can see the children playing in the front. Now, some of those animals are going to have trouble getting along. Lions tend to eat lambs for dinner. And you can see in the background there are the indigenous people of his time and Quakers. And at the time that he painted this, those two groups were at war. But in the painting, he draws them speaking together peacefully. God promises that one day all animals and all people will get along together. This is God's promise. So be ready to be surprised. So in your worship art today, I would like you to draw your version of Isaiah chapter 11, your vision of that peace-filled kingdom. What would have to change for that peace to come? Let's pray. God of peace and possibility, we turn to your word to hear your will and your wisdom for our times. Open our hearts and minds by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, so that we might hear what you are saying to the church through Christ, our Prince of Peace. Amen. Our responsive psalm is selected verses from Psalm 72. Endow the king with your justice, O God, the royal son with your righteousness. May the mountains bring prosperity to the people, the hills the fruit of righteousness. May he endure as long as the sun, as long as the moon, through all generations. In his days may the righteous flourish and prosperity abound till the moon is no more. Praise be to his glorious name forever.
Our scripture lesson this morning is from Isaiah chapter 11, 1 to 10. The prophet Isaiah speaks of one who comes from the family of Jesse, who will have the Spirit of the Lord on him. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of might, the spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. In that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. Thanks be to God.
What I'm about to say, I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 11 is a diptych. It's a hinged pair of paintings. And on the left, we see a young king. He exudes vitality, strength, severity, and joy. There is deep wisdom in his eyes. On the distant hills behind him, cruel-faced monarchs lie dead, and in the forefront, the poor gaze up with him with radiance. The panel on the right shows a fantastic menagerie. There are sleek carnivores, leopard, wolf, lion, bear, and there are domestic animals, calf, lamb, ox, goat. Predator and prey are lounging together. A child is singing to them. A toddler plays happily by a nest of rattlesnakes. The painting on the left is entitled Justice, and the painting on the right, Peace. This is the promise of God. Now, these are beautiful words set in a book of violence and destruction. In the previous chapter, Isaiah declares that God has given the northern kingdom Israel, as well as many cities in Judah, into the hands of the kings of Assyria. And why? Because God, through Isaiah, wants the people to know why they will be judged. And we know why. Read the Old Testament and you can't miss it. Israel's kings think only of themselves and have increased their power and their wealth at the expense of the poor and marginalized. Magistrates take bribes. Everyone worships idols. They pollute the land. Because of their injustice and idolatry, God will allow the Assyrians to destroy Israel. Is that it then? Is this the end of Israel? No. God has bigger plans in mind, and it will begin with a new king. And what a king this is. This king is wise and discerning because he knows the Lord. And while we talk about blind justice, this king is both deaf and blind because he will rule with righteousness in covenant faithfulness so that God's concern for the needy, for the poor, will be reflected in all his decisions. And instead of military might, this ruler will change the world through the power of his word. His words fill the earth with the knowledge of the Lord until it is like the water of the ocean, creation's great reservoir and the beginning of life. Who was this king? Within Judaism, these words were applied to King Hezekiah of Judah, and he certainly had a lot going for him. In 2 Kings and 2 Chronicles, they attest to his attempts to bring Judah back to God. He centralized worship in Jerusalem so as to eliminate idolatry in the high places. He reformed the Levitical and priestly roles, and he reestablished the Passover pilgrimages. Hezekiah was a good king, but he did not introduce world peace. As Christians, we believe that these words were fulfilled in Jesus Christ. It is on the Lord Jesus that the Spirit of God descends when he is baptized. It is in Jesus of Nazareth's first sermon that he declares that he has come to bring good news to the poor. And it is Jesus who criticizes the religious leaders, the so-called good people, but blesses the poor and eats with sinners. At his birth, the angels sing of peace. It is Jesus who ushers in God's peace-filled kingdom. Now, justice and peace go together. You can't have peace without justice. And when you have justice, then peace spreads throughout all of God's creation. And that's what we see in this second panel of the diptych, peace, not just among humans, but among all the natural world. Isaiah's vision of what God was doing in this new king is much wider than we usually assume. The promise is reconciliation and restoration for all of God's creation. The peace that God's Messiah will bring means a flourishing of all life, not just human. Now, Woody Allen once quipped that the day may well come when the lion will lay down with the lamb, but the lamb isn't going to get much sleep. Allen was just being funny, but he does have a point. Isaiah's vision of former foes living together peacefully implies more than a photo op. This is not just changes on the surface. Isaiah is talking about a transformation of the heart. The lamb can sleep because the lion has lost all appetite for anything served with mint jelly. And the parents of that toddler need to know that the snake can be trusted whether or not someone is watching. Isaiah is looking for the day when all people have become so enmeshed in God's vision for the cosmos and its flourishing that the possibility of abusing the poor will be no more. Justice and peace together, this is God's promise. Let's go back to the first verse of our text. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. It's a reference to the Davidic line and to the kings who are heirs to David's throne. But it is also a hint to us about the nature of God's peaceful kingdom that is coming and yet is among us now. After a war, the landscape is bleak and lifeless, from a distance that's all you see, shades of gray. But zoom in, and you will see life emerging. You will see shoots coming up out of the stump. So it is with God's kingdom of peace. Now, it's strange. It's strange. You in a construction site, you see workers wearing heavy-duty headsets to protect their ears against the noise of the jackhammer. Concrete is hard to break up. It's drilling and pounding. It takes a while before you see the cracks. So how is it that somehow green shoots find their way up through our sidewalks? We didn't plan it. There's no jackhammers involved, and yet tender shoots no bigger than your baby finger push through the concrete to the sunlight. It's a miracle. God's kingdom of peace is among us, and God continues to surprise us. Do you remember when the Berlin Wall came down? Who would have thought that that day would ever come? One day it's there, massive and ugly, and the next day families are reunited, crying and hugging each other. The tearing down did seem to happen very quickly. But before that wonderful day, there were green shoots, signs of hope, signs of God's presence, so easy to miss unless you were paying attention, unless you were zooming in for a closer look. Barbara Lundblad tells a story of a man on her street. They'd known each other for years. They used to meet on the way to get a newspaper. And then his wife died. 40 years together changed to loneliness, and she watched him walking, his head bowed, his shoulders drooping lower each day. His whole body seemed in mourning, cut off from everyone. Lundblad got used to saying good morning without any response. Until one day, she saw him coming. And before she could say anything, he nodded and said, "Good morning, Reverend. Going for your paper?" He walked beside her, eager to talk. And she had no idea what had brought this change that seemed so sudden. And perhaps for him, it wasn't sudden at all, but painfully so, like a seedling pushing through rock toward the sunlight. There must have been an explanation. But for her, it seemed like a miracle. Vivian Ketchum is a member of Place of Hope Presbyterian Church in Winnipeg. She grew up in our residential school in Kenora. And if you watched the video on the Presbyterian website, you would have heard Vivian explaining why Orange Shirt Day is so important to Indigenous people. And despite the pain of her childhood, Vivian has never turned her back on God. She has never given up on the church. She continues to teach us to share her story, to reach out in love. This past June, age 58, Vivian graduated from high school. God's peaceful kingdom is among us, and God is here, tapping us on the shoulder, saying, "Look, look over there. Do you see that green shoot?" Isaiah spoke to a trampled people in a trampled land. He spoke of God's coming kingdom of justice and peace this Advent. Be ready to be surprised. Thanks be to God. Our hymn is Benediction. Please stand. Let's sing together. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Those who come to me will never go hungry, and those who believe in me will never be thirsty. No one who comes to me will I drive away. Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. So whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do everything for the glory of God. Let's stand and sing together, I Come With Joy.
I come with joy, a child of God, forgiven, loved, and free. The life of Jesus to recall, the love laid down for me, a love laid down for me. I come with Christians far and near to find that all are free. Communion bread, in Christ's communion bread. As Christ brings bread and bids us share each proud division, ends the love that makes us faith as one, as strangers now our friends, and strangers now our friends. The Spirit of the risen Christ, unseen but ever near, he searched a friendship better known than love's among us here, alive among us here. Together met, together bound by all that God has done, we'll go with joy to give the world the love that makes us one.
Let's profess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Holy God, creator of heaven and earth, with joy we give you thanks and praise. Through the words of your prophets, you gave your people hope by promising them the Redeemer. And now we rejoice that in your Son, Jesus Christ, the Savior has come and will come again in power and glory, making all things new. How marvelous are your ways, Almighty God. How wonderful is your name, O Holy One. You alone are God. Therefore, with apostles and prophets and that great crowd of witnesses who live for you beyond all time and space, we lift our hearts in joyful praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise you, Most High God, for sending your only Son, Jesus, to live among us, full of grace and truth. Sharing our joy and sorrow, he healed the sick and was a friend of sinners. Obeying you, he took up his cross and died that we might live. We praise you that he overcame death and is risen to rule the world. He is still the friend of sinners. We trust him. to overcome every power that can hurt or divide us, and believe that when he comes in glory, we will celebrate victory with him. Therefore, in remembrance of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we take this bread and this cup and give you praise and thanksgiving as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and wine, that we and all who share this feast may be one with Christ and he with us. Here we offer ourselves to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you. In your mercy, accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Fill us with the joy of eternal life, that we may be your faithful people until we feast with you in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honors are yours, Almighty God, forever and ever. And the people say, Amen. As the Lord taught us, now let us pray together. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and said, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Every time you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you declare the death of the Lord until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Sins away, slain for us, and we remember the promise made for all who come in faith, find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink his sacrifice as a sign of the bonds of peace. Around the table of the King, the body of our Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of the bonds of peace. around the table of the King. That cleanses every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drained death's cup that all who enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread. And we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of the bonds of grace around the table of the King. Around the table of the King. Thankfulness and faith we rise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his body here on earth. As we share in his suffering, we proclaim Christ will come again, and we join in the feast of heaven around the table of the King. Around the table of the King.
Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. God of the peaceable kingdom Isaiah envisioned, where predator and prey are reconciled and children play in safety, we give you thanks for every step taken toward reconciliation among rivals and every program provided to give children a reliable future. Thank you for policies implemented on behalf of the climate and every vulnerable creature. to give us all hope for an enduring future in the world you love. For peace will not come if the world keeps tilting out of balance. God of John the Baptist's rallying cry, you raised up John in the wilderness as a voice calling us to conversion. We thank you for signs of renewal and change in the church and in communities grappling with historic injustice and current outcry. Guide advocates who work for change with both courage and compassion. As we await the coming of Christ, awaken the church to new ways to undertake ministry and mission, and give us the energy and resources to reach out in ways we have yet to imagine. God of steadfast encouragement, St. Paul called the followers of Christ to live in harmony and welcome those perceived as strangers to you and to them. Thank you for welcoming us when we were strangers to a new community, a new church, or a life changed by unexpected circumstance. We pray for people who dread this Christmas season because life has changed for them, or circumstances leave them feeling lonely and discouraged. Draw close to those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, and guide us to reach out to someone who needs comfort or encouragement. God of justice and equity, the Psalms, the prophets, and the Gospels proclaim your care for the poor and your expectation that your people will look to the needs of the vulnerable. We thank you that Canada has resources to share and pray that our leaders will attend to long-standing injustice and urgent need without excuse or delay. We pray for places torn apart by war and for communities devastated by storm, flood, fire, or drought. Challenge any who would hoard scarce resources or profit from the needs of others. Open our hearts to share what we can, even in these difficult times. Amen. Our closing hymn is "For the Bread That You Have Broken." Let's stand and sing together. God's peace-filled kingdom, and the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit rest upon each one of you, now and forevermore. Amen.
In the highest, in the highest, in the highest. highest, in the highest.